In that music as we gather. So But I truly do appreciate all the effort and all the talent that these two put into this special part of our worship. Because it is part of worship.
Amen.
Let's stand as the Bible just sent you.
According to World Food Program, as many as 828 million people are unsure of where their next meal will be coming from.
Water security is essential for food security.
Let us pray for those living with water scarcity around the world.
Holy God, whose spirit moved over the waters at the dawn of creation, hear our prayers for all those who thirst today. We pray for those who are spiritually thirsty, who long to know your presence, but who don't know where to find you. We pray for those who are alone and without hope, those who long to feel needed and loved, those who are searching for meaning and purpose.
O healing river, pour down your waters and heal your people. We pray for all who are physically thirsty, who don't have enough water to drink or feed their animals, whose fields are parched, whose crops have withered, those who have to walk long distances to find enough water to survive, or who have to be content with water that is unclean. We pray for those whose homes and villages are torn apart because of drought or famine.
O healing river, pour down your waters and heal your people. We pray for those who are thirsty for justice, for those who long for an equal sharing of resource among peoples and nations, those who put their lives at risk to protect streams and rivers and oceans, and for those who are working to find clean water and make it available to those who need it.
O healing river, pour down your waters and heal your people. God, we ask that you would open our hearts to the needs of all who thirst. Give us courage to work together for justice, to stand alongside those who are thirsty, so that all people everywhere may live without want or fear, and may discover the abundant life you promise to each one. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of living water, we pray. Amen.
Canadian Food Grains Bank.
Good morning, and as we saw, today is World Water Day, and as he was saying, if you want to, I'd like to donate to Canadian Food Grains, which they send money for water to. You can just simply mark it on your envelope for Water Day or Canadian Food Grains, and we'll make sure it gets sent there. Okay, today is our AGM day. The agenda is prepared, and it's available to different parts around the church, on the foyer, some on the day afternoon table. Anna will have a table set up in there, and if you want to see her when you go in, you can put your name down as a mover or a seconder and make the meeting go more swiftly. But I'll explain that a bit more in a minute. There will be a Palm Sunday choir rally on April 7th, our 2nd at 3 here at Memorial. Come and support the vocal and the choirs within the presbytery. Now, we said a bit about the Scamler reminder, but I just want to remind you again, neither we, this church here, our PWSND, our Presbyterian Sharing, or the Presbyterian Church in Canada, none of them will call to solicit donations and ask for your credit card number or personal information. If any organization calls you wanting that information, please disconnect and call the business back at the number you know, and odds are that they really didn't place that number. So just be aware of that, because that's happening more frequently. Okay, I just want to tell you about the AGM. Reverend Ben is going to say grace before we go here. We want you to go in, fill your plate up, sit down, and as soon as Anna sees everyone sitting, we'll start the meeting. Okay? And get your tea and coffee. We'll prepare that way. Okay, thank you.
Morning.
Good morning.
Let's just hope I remember to say grace. We don't want to throw off any schedules. This morning, we're looking at the light of Christ. Are we blind to that light? Have we always been blind to that light? Have we been blind from birth? What is the whole concept of being able to see Christ, and perhaps even displaying Christ to who we are? Let us come into God's presence with our call to worship. The Lord is our shepherd.
He leads us by still waters.
He restores our souls.
He leads us in right paths.
Even though we walk through the darkest valley,
we fear no evil. God is with us.
Come, let us worship our God. The Lord is my shepherd.
Gracious and loving God,
come before you in praise. You are compassionate, hearing all who call out for mercy. You are healing, offering wholeness to all who cry out in pain. You are truth, showing the way to all who seek the fullness of life. You are hope, bringing the promise of a new day to all people. And you are happiness, blessing all who love you with abundance and joy. At all times and in all circumstances, you are perfect grace and hope. And we are moved to worship you as our God. We confess, Lord, that we have not always lived in the abundant life that you offer to your people. We resist the fullness of your truth, taking up only those parts that fit in with our lives and our limited vision. When we see miracles, we dismiss them. We demand proof of your presence and power over and over again, instead of fully embracing and trusting you. And in fear, we judge others harshly, and we fail to see your grace at work in their lives. Help us to be a people that can see and discern your presence in the world. Open our eyes to your healing power and mercy. And change our hearts so that we may experience the fullness of Christ's love and light. For all of these things, Lord, we pray in Christ's name. You know, once our lives were touched through darkness, but through Jesus Christ, we live in the light. So we need to live as children of light, knowing that we are forgiven and strengthened, and to extend grace and forgiveness to all others. May that grace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
This morning our anthem is more of a praise song, so we're asking you to help us out a little bit with the chorus. I think we've got words up here when those happen. The choir's going to sing it the first time. There's four verses and choruses in between. By the end you should be able to figure it out. And sing. You'll do a good job.
Thank you. for the fourth Sunday in Lent. Just as the Spirit drove Jesus into the wilderness,
the Spirit leads us into places of uncertainty where we confront our weakness and insecurities.
Here we are taught to pay attention to those whom others ignore.
Jesus insists that God's grace is revealed in unlikely people.
God's realm is a place where all are welcome, regardless of their state or position. In a world of disparity, we recognize that some receive what is denied to others.
Let us break through barriers that keep many from receiving the grace that they need.
Listen in our hearts. But your word taught us to pray. You taught us to pray that we would hear the truth in the word of God. So we come at this time asking you to illuminate these pages and help us truly see what you would offer to us this day. Amen. Want a hymn? How, oh, Lord of Light. Good thing you're here.
Piano playing 101, and there's the one. probably not even read, right? We just know.
That's right.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters.
He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
First scripture reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try and find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful work of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore, it says, sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.
Shying away from the next one, Sharon? Thank you. We're going to continue as we turn to the Gospel of John. We're going to read verses 1 to 40 from John chapter 9. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. He asked his disciples, or his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's work might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then he went and he washed and came back, able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some were saying, it is he. Others were saying, no, but it is someone like him. He kept saying, I am the man. But they kept asking him, then how are your eyes opened? He answered, the man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. Then I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, where is he? He said, I do not know. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. And then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, you put mud on my eyes, then I washed, now I see. And some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner perform such signs? And they were divided. So they again said again to the blind man, what do you say about him? Was your eyes opened? He said, he is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it was that he now sees. Nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews. For the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. And therefore his parents said, "He is of age. Ask him." So for the second time they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." And they said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I've told you already and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and you're trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." The Lord bless to us this reading of his own word. "You are his disciple, we are disciples of Moses." It's fascinating that one little piece in that scripture. Because I get a sense that Christ must have been sitting on the outside of the temple like he usually was. Sort of like sitting at the cenotaph in the park across the way. Not going into worship, just sort of observing. And I wonder what Jesus thought about when what that temple tradition had become as he sat there observing all of this. At some point, he must have agreed with his father that he should never have allowed Moses to build a place for God to dwell. You see, God had always wanted to just dwell in the hearts of his people, but the people wanted a place. If we go join Jesus over there at Cenotaph, and we look at the church today, is the church what Christ would have envisioned? So many different denominations, traditional, conservative, liberal, social, evangelical. Some can't agree with anyone else, find the devil in every detail. Some welcome the devil in an attempt to redeem him. Some invite all people. Some only invite the chosen few. They all have merit. They all have different church issues. But each one serves those who seek and look for what each denomination offers. We don't all agree. Sometimes it's hard to wonder if we even agree on who Christ is. And I wonder, did Christ envision this? Or did he envision sending his workers out to the harvest? So it leaves us asking the question, can we at least see the best in each other? And try to realize that we all serve a risen Christ. And to serve Christ in the mission that he left us with, each in our own way. And another thing I wonder is if Christ would recognize what we'll be doing after our worship service today, our AGM. Our annual general meeting, reviewing the business of the church. I don't know, I can see Christ just scratching there a little bit, saying, the business of the church. Well, do you know what the business of the church is? No. And now this year, we've changed that to be a little less business-like, and a little bit more community fellowship-like, which is a good thing. Would Jesus have recognized the year-end business review of the church? Or is that in tune with putting your hand to the plow and looking back? He told us to put your hand on the plow and not look. It seems that we've become obsessed with the church as a business. Concern over budgets, failing congregations, meeting expenses, looking after buildings and cutting missions to maintain order. I mean, I understand all of this, and I know the church needs a place, a home, a plant or a base to worship. But then, would Jesus recognize that? Even the fox has a den, but the Son of Man We just had a presbytery meeting this past week. And I like the presbyterial form of governance within the church that gives equality to all people in the expression and practice of a shared faith. But again, I wonder, would Christ recognize how we now seem to spend so much time in making sure that congregations can maintain traditions, buildings, and do things properly, decently, and in good order? We need these things to enable us to do mission. But sometimes it feels like we lose sight of being sent out with just your staff and your cloak. And when Jesus recognized the church today that isolates people deemed to be sinners. And this time was the blind and the lame. Those people who are obviously sinners, because these conditions are obviously God's judgment upon them. And therefore, they do not belong. Would the discrimination done in the name of God, you don't believe as I do or we do, so therefore, you're sinners. Perhaps Jesus would suggest that we remove love from our eyes before we start casting judgment. It's almost as if we've been blind from birth and we know nothing but darkness. It's almost as if our whole world is darkness until that wonderful moment when we wash in the pool of Siloam. Stay there because it's easier to hide than live in the light. So we have this wonderful story of John's Gospel. And because it's John's story, we know that there's more to this story than just what meets the ear. He wants us to see the spiritual truth. John always puts the spiritual truth into his writings. So, who sinned? This man or his parents? Now, to answer that question, or to even think about that question, we're reaching way back into the Old Testament where children are punished for the sins of their fathers. But the short answer to the disciples' question is, no. There's a truth here. The truth is that we dwell in a world of sin. It's a world of sin. Christ didn't make this man blind. He was born into a sinful world, which led to his blindness. But it was God in this world who would help with that sin. And so perhaps he was blind so that the power of God could be shown to all people. This man was born blind so that God could be revealed. We all exist within that darkness. Through Adam came that darkness. But this man's blindness will show the light of life. love of God through Jesus Christ. Now, we really don't have time to unpack this whole story, but there are a few things that we can look at. There's a wonderful truth that John leads us to in this story that we might have missed if we're not careful. The blind man did not see who healed him. Nor did he ask to be healed. And yet, even after being interrogated by the Pharisees, he knew who it was. He knew that God had touched him, and he knew Jesus must be a prophet of God. There's two examples of John's revealing the true light of God. And again, we go back to the Old Testament prophecies. And one is the Pharisees' refusal to see or perhaps relinquish their hold on their own tradition. John is telling us there's a new light shining in the darkness. And that is the light of the Messiah. It's no wonder the Pharisees had such a hard time with that. Because their whole tradition was being called into question. Just imagine if your whole tradition of the Christian church was called into question. And it wasn't until after the formerly, I love the way they do this, after the formerly blind man's parents had been brought in and the interrogation was over and that the man had been excommunicated, that Jesus went to find him. And did you get that at one point? It wasn't until after everything had happened, Jesus went to find him. After he'd been kicked out of the synagogue, out of the temple tradition, because he could see. You can't even begin to fathom that. Because he could see, you get kicked out of their religion. The Jewish traditional form of religion kicked them out because they were blind to Jesus. They were blind to what really happened, what happened. And it's fascinating that Jesus went looking for the man and asked him if he believed in the Son of Man. Now, as we determined, he didn't see who healed him. He didn't ask to be healed. He just did as he was told. He believed in the Son of Man. What context is there for that man to answer that question? Just one. Only God could make a man born blind see. Only God. He wanted to believe in God. He wanted to worship God. But was not allowed to do so from within the community of believers that he belonged to. It wasn't until Christ came received in a community of love. To know something incredible happened. It says to Jesus, "Who is he, sir? Tell me who he is that I may believe in him." You have seen him. Not because you're looking at him, but because you understand the truth of the power of God. And you've seen that. I wonder sometimes, do we share the light of Christ from within our faith? Do we share the light of Christ from within our church, or we have lost sight of the mission of the church? Instead of becoming insular, like the Pharisees in our story this morning, guarding against that which we deem unacceptable. But what Jesus, the Son of God, clearly brings into the light. Paul tells us that there's a natural response to the love of Christ, the redeeming light of Jesus, that saving grace from the cross that allows us to move out of the darkness of the sinful world light of God's grace and mercy. Do you know what that is? The natural response? It's you. For once, you. We are that you. You were the darkness. But now in the Lord, you are light. He says, live as children of the light. For the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and is right and is true. Can we live in that light? Do we live in that light? How can we possibly live in that light? And what effect would that light and on the world? Open my eyes that I may see. Lord of light and love, we rejoice that you have opened our eyes to see you, to see the world in truth of your love. Accept the gifts that we bring to you, and let your love shine upon them that they might help others to see you as we share in the ministry that you have left for us. Lord, we unite our hearts here in this place and at this time to pray for your people, to lift them before you, each in our own thoughts and minds. We come before you with prayers of our hearts, those things that only we know that we desire to share with you. We come together with our corporate prayer for your church and for the world. There is so much darkness. Help us to share your light, your hope, and your peace. Lord, hear our prayer as we offer to you in the prayer that you taught us to say.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing.
Try and start on every land, and we
Lord, as we leave this place and go to a time of meeting and a time of fellowship, we ask that you will bless the meal where we see the fellowship that we share. For we pray this.